Psychology of Healing. Why Letting Go May Not Always Work, by Aion Farvahar. Our emotional wounds are created during painful events in our past. But it is not the events that caused these emotional wounds, but the meaning we chose to give to them when they happened. So healing is not about forgetting or letting go of those events, but about noticing and transforming the meaning we chose to give them. Hi, this is Aion Farvahar. I'm glad you're here. This channel is about self-realization and honoring our life purpose and meaning. If you're interested in these topics, please subscribe to stay connected. Your support is the foundation of this channel and encourages me to create more content in the future. For more information about myself and my life mentoring practice, please find my bio link in the description below. Also, for more information about the artist behind the expressive images I use here, please see the description below. Today, we want to focus on psychology of healing. Psychological healing is the foundation of life, because when we are not emotionally well, it would be hard to focus and pursue what we want in life. That is probably why counseling and psychotherapy have been on the rise and have become a widely accepted part of life, especially in urban areas. Even individuals who cannot afford psychotherapy are taking the path of a wounded healer and work on themselves to heal and transform. But despite its recognition and popularity, conventional psychotherapy may not always lead to healing and can, through time, become a means to cope with our emotional wounds so we can navigate life. As valuable as psychotherapy is, its effectiveness for lasting emotional well-being can be plateaued and diminished with time. Psychospiritual modalities, such as Jungian psychology and IFS, can be more effective because they view psychological healing as a step toward wholeness, individuation, and self-leadership. This presentation invites you to become curious about psychology of healing, or what it takes for someone to truly heal. More specifically, we cover the following topics. Anatomy of trauma. How a difficult life experience becomes a trauma. How we tend to give meaning to our difficult experiences. Why simply letting go does not always heal. Redemption, the key to lasting psychological healing. And how to let go of and heal our past. Please note that I'm not a psychologist, and the information provided here are based on my personal experience and understanding, and does not reflect an academic view on psychology. If you're interested in academic perspectives, please refer to classic books on psychology and psychotherapy. Anatomy of trauma. How a difficult life experience becomes a trauma. Life is full of challenges and difficult experiences, many of which are unavoidable. These include setbacks, heartbreaks, rejections, and failures that make us doubt our worth and confidence. For example, an undesirable break in an emotional relationship can make us feel abandoned and unworthy of love. Or the loss of things or people that we love or value can make us feel empty and alone. Many of us don't want to remember our difficult experiences because that reminds us of the emotional pain we experienced back then. But life is by design a hero's journey of transformation when we need to face difficult challenges and learn to overcome them. Today, we are wiser than yesterday because we have had more experience. In other words, unless we hide in a cave, Having difficult and painful experiences is an inseparable part of life. But what makes a difficult experience feel traumatic? What is trauma? When does a difficult experience become a trauma? A difficult experience becomes a trauma when the meaning of it is affecting our emotional well-being. In that sense, trauma has two components. One is the event or the difficult experience itself, which is what happened to us. The other is how we felt inside because of that event and what happened to us. One of these, which is the event or difficult experience itself, is often out of our control. However, we have far more control over how we felt as a result, because that feeling is created by our own mind. Stating it differently, it is not the event or difficult experience that causes the trauma, but the emotional pain we experienced as the result of that. But where does this emotional pain come from? Who creates it? We do. But why? A difficult experience becomes a trauma because of the emotional pain our mind feels as a result. But how this emotional pain is created? Very often, the emotional pain itself is created by a meaning that we chose to give to what happened. Let me use an example to clarify this. If I get rejected in a job interview that I really cared about, my mind may view this rejection as a sign that I'm not smart enough or have bad luck. This is the meaning my mind gives to that rejection, which may not be fair or represent reality. The belief that I'm not smart enough or have bad luck makes me feel sad and worried, because if I'm not smart and have bad luck, how can I pursue what I want in life? I'm now sad and worried, not because I got rejected in a job interview, but because I chose to believe that I'm not smart enough or have bad luck. This is the meaning my mind gave to my rejection in order to understand and justify it. Hope you find this example helpful in making a distinction between a difficult experience, a meaning one gives to that experience, and the emotional pain implied in that meaning. Hope you can notice that it is not our difficult experiences that cause us pain, but the meaning a part of us chose to give to them in order to understand why they happened. This is the key to understanding trauma. How we tend to give meaning to our difficult experiences. We humans are sentient and intelligent beings. We need to understand the point of everything we experience, especially our difficult experiences. We are not good in living with unanswered questions and cannot get on with life without understanding. We need to know why certain things happen to us, and to do that, we attach a meaning to them. We tend to attach meaning to our painful experiences because that's the only way we can understand and come to terms with why they happened. Unfortunately, in most cases, the meaning we choose to give to our difficult experiences is negative and self-critical in nature. Let's define what I mean here by attaching a meaning to an experience. We attach meaning to an experience when we let what happened to us define who we are as a person or how we view ourselves as an individual. This is the most important point shared here. So let's consider another example to clarify it. Imagine I experience an unexpected break in a loving relationship, and I'm now puzzled and need to understand why that had to happen. If I don't want to blame the other person, I have to blame myself, maybe believing I'm not good enough or worthy of that love. So for me to understand why that happened, I choose to give a meaning to it, which is I'm probably not good enough or not worthy of love. If I choose to believe that, I experience emotional pain and may feel sad and lonely. In that sense, I let what happened to me, which was a break in a relationship, define who I am as a person, because that is the simplest way to understand it. This negative and self-critical belief helps me justify and come to terms with what happened to me, even if that belief is not fair or realistic. Similarly, if I did not receive enough parental love growing up, I may justify that by believing that I was a bad child and not lovable. My belief is not fair or realistic, but helps me come to terms with why I did not receive enough parental love. The key point here is that we have been conditioned by our difficult experiences and the meaning we chose to give to them in order to justify and come to terms with them. When we view things morally and give moral meaning to our experiences, we let what happened to us define how we view ourselves as a person. But is that really fair? Probably not, because not everything that happens to us has enough merits to define who we are as a person. Now, if you feel comfortable, I would invite you to do an inner contemplation about one of the difficult experiences you had in the past, which may still have emotions attached to it. Think of a negative experience you had in the past, maybe failing a business venture, being rejected in a job interview, or a break in a close relationship. When that happened, what did you tell yourself? What meaning did you give to that experience? Do you notice any self-critical thoughts? Maybe blaming yourself, doubting your abilities or self-worth? If you notice you had a self-critical thought back then, what did that thought make you feel? Did you feel sad, misunderstood, inadequate, unfairly treated, not respected, and so on? If you feel that way, can you see how you might have unknowingly gave a meaning to what happened and let that meaning define how you view yourself? If you're not able to see how that experience led you to you holding some emotional pain, consider repeating this contemplation on your own at a later time. Why simply letting go does not always heal. As explained, we tend to attach meaning to our difficult experiences. This meaning often makes us feel sad, inadequate, unworthy, abundant, and so on. This causes our difficult experiences to feel traumatic. For example, if I were wrongly blamed and punished for something I did not do when I was 5 years old, and no one believed me, my 5-year-old inner child may feel sad, misunderstood, and unfairly treated. No matter how educated and accomplished I become later in life, My inner child still remains sad and misunderstood. And because he is a part of me, I feel his emotions as an adult and may become oversensitive to situations where I'm being unfairly blamed by others. It is empirically observed, for example, in IFS inner work, that the negative emotions we carry is not really ours as adults, but belong to wounded younger parts of us who felt that way in the past. Because painful events in the past drain our life energy, many wounded individuals often choose to forget and let go of those painful events. But simply letting go of a painful event does not really heal the deeper emotional pain attached to it. In the contrary, by ignoring or letting go of a painful event, we unintentionally exile and disown a wounded part of ourselves, usually an inner child or adolescent who holds that pain and is looking for redemption to heal from it. When we let go of our painful experiences without healing them, we essentially exile our wounded parts and can experience soul loss as if a part of us is missing inside. That is why, no matter how strong-willed we may be, letting go of the past may not always bring genuine healing, especially when it comes to our deeper emotional wounds. This is because we adults are not the ones to let go of what happened, but rather our younger wounded parts who still hold pain from the past. Letting go only works and brings a real sense of healing when the younger versions of us that hold the pain choose to let go. And for that to happen, these younger versions of us need redemption, need to say whatever was not said, and need to be listened to and validated. Until then, simply letting go cannot lead to genuine and lasting healing. Redemption, the key to lasting psychological healing. We can heal our traumas only when the younger wounded parts of us who experienced them feel redeemed. From experience, this redemption usually requires the following conditions. Wounded parts need to feel seen and acknowledged. This is because our wounded parts hold emotional pain and are usually stuck in the past and feel lonely. Wounded parts need to share their side of the story about what happened and how they felt because of that. This is because our wounded parts usually have a lot to say about what they feel, but did not have anybody to talk to in the past. Wounded parts open up to let go of their pain once they realize that the meaning they gave to their painful experiences may not have been fair or true. Wounded parts heal when they let go of the meaning they gave to their experiences, release the pain they carry, and restore their authentic true nature in that age. These conditions bring a sense of redemption to our wounded parts and give them courage to let go and heal. Psychological techniques like IFS are highly effective in facilitating these conditions, bringing redemption and healing to our wounded parts. How to let go and heal our past. It is known from psychology that our personality is mostly formed during our childhood and adolescence years. Our difficult experiences during these early years tend to be more traumatic because we are dependent on others to survive. Majority of our wounded parts are younger versions of ourselves in the past who experienced difficult events in different ages. So in order to let go and heal our past, We need to get to know and help our younger wounded parts redeem themselves. Only when our younger parts feel redeemed, they open up to let go and heal. So if you have had painful experiences in the past that you would like to let go, you need to do some inner work to get to know the younger parts of you that experienced them. It is better to do this inner work with some help, maybe an IFS therapist or practitioner. But if you feel comfortable doing this work by yourself, you need to consider the followings. List any negative or self-critical feelings or beliefs you notice in you but wish you could let go of. For each, check how young you were when you first started having that feeling or belief. Check if you remember what event could have created that feeling or belief. Find the younger version of you that started feeling or believing that. Open your heart and extend compassion and curiosity toward this younger part of you. You can use old pictures of yourself around that age. As your heart is open and non-judgmental, intuitively let this younger version of you know who you are and that you are here to be with it and listen to it. This makes your younger part feel seen and connected. Ask your younger part to tell you what it wants you to know about what happened and how it felt. Check if your younger part has given a meaning to that event, which may not be fair or true. Help your younger part realize that the meaning it gave to the event was not so fair or true. Let it know how you view the event in a more positive way. Check if the younger part of you is open to let go of the negative feeling or belief it carries. If not, address what your younger part needs in order to be open to let go and heal. Help the younger part see a better future when this negative feeling or belief is no longer there. Once your younger part let go and releases the negative feeling or belief, ask it to invite positive feeling or belief instead, and invite it to come to the present and experience life alongside you. In closing, remember that it is not our difficult experiences that bring us emotional pain, but the meaning we chose to give them in order to understand why they happened. Because of this, simply letting go and forgetting what happened cannot bring a real sense of healing. And to truly heal our emotional pain, we need to find its originating event and the meaning our younger wounded part gave to it, which caused that pain. Letting go can lead to healing when younger wounded parts of us feel redeemed and open up to let go. And we are the only one who can help them do that. Remember that we all need to let go and heal, because our real life starts only when we are truly healed. If you have found this presentation insightful, please like and share it with your like-minded friends. Please subscribe to my channel and share your thoughts and comments. For more information about myself and my life mentoring practice, please find my bio link in the description below. Blessings.